Excited with this diverse coalition, so please, let's make some noise. I'm gonna repeat that. Make some noise. One more time, let's break the stereotype. Make some noise. That actually got me a couple of goosebumps. So one last, 87 days to election. It is our task to get everyone registered. And once we're registered, get everybody to go out there and vote. Because ladies and gentlemen, we will now introduce
of Caesar Palace.
Entertainment, we're honored to be part of this momentous event.
Joining us as well online. As we feature this of the Asian American Journalists Association is half the equation here today. And one of our leading figures, Richard Louie, who, as you know, is anchor for MSNBC, has a program on the weekend in which he's going to bring some of the interviews from today's event to air. So not only do you have an opportunity to hear this today, but you will have an opportunity to hear it on Richard's program over the weekend as well. So I'd ask now Richard Louie and his first guest to come forward and join us. And I do have questions as well for our guest here and for Richard as part of this program. Richard. Hey.
How do you translate that, huh? Quite an event we have here today, and I am so glad to have Governor Gary Johnson here today.
Thank you.
As you know, he is the Libertarian presidential nominee, and when we first reached out to his campaign, they energetically, fervently, and with joy said yes. So thank you so much, Governor.
Well, and all of you recognize.
Well, he's got jokes. Governor, let's start with this, and you just addressed it. Why do you want to run to be president of the
two-term Republicans? Is in their own lives, as long as those choices don't adversely affect others. And then I think a unique third leg to the stool is I do believe that when we involve ourselves in regime change, when we use our military to intervene, I think it has had the unintended with free trade, let's bring the world together with diplomacy.
So you've laid it all out there for us. As we think about it, one of the headlines that is common when we see Gary Johnson, the esteemed governor from New Mexico, the Libertarian candidate to be president, is, will this be a wasted vote? You've heard this many a time. Why is it not a wasted vote?
Well, a wasted vote is voting for Trump.
Well, help us out with this then. Give us a glimpse behind the factory doors at the Johnson campaign. Because when you look at the Real Clear Politics average, which I know you watch here and there, it's about 8%. You got to get to the magic 15, as you know, to be part of the debates, and that's an important part, I know, of what you'd like to do.
Well, there's no way that I'm going to win the presidency if I'm not in the presidential debates. And to be in the presidential debates, you have to be at 15%. I think right now, I think our consensus number is probably around 10. I saw 2 weeks ago that the projected audience for the first presidential debate is going to exceed the Super Bowl. Well, there's no way that you can win the presidency without being in that game. I do think that there's a real possibility that we will be in the presidential debates.
So let's just say, please, let's just say we are at one of those debates right now. What will you say to Secretary Clinton, the Democratic presidential nominee?
Well, I'm going to stay on message that small government is a good. I do. Polarizing figures in American politics today are running for office. Where's the 43% of Americans that declare themselves as independent? I think there's a big six-lane highway down the middle of Republicans and Democrats right now that Bill Weld and myself occupy.
Okay, so a lot of these voters that you're talking about, independents, those who are in the middle, those who are love to shop to the very last minute and then finally pull that lever and make a vote, right? They're going, who's this guy? Who is this guy? Who is Governor Gary Johnson?
Yeah.
And tell me which of all of those.
And diplomacy.
Two words in the Midwest. You don't want to bring that up because we look at many of the industries that have been hurt and they look at those particular letters and go, Governor Johnson, that's not good.
Well, first of all, crony capitalism is alive and well, okay? Crony capitalism, when government interjects itself into the economy, picks winners and losers, and I'm afraid, what it is described as, devoid of government interference. So I do support TPP. Is it a perfect document? No, nothing really is, but my pledge to all of you, if I'm elected president, is I'm going to sign on to anything that makes things better, and I'm not doing this in a void, so my economic advisors have told me that this does make things better. It does remove barriers to free trade.
Governor, I'm not good with these economic policy things. Tell me what TPP is in one sentence.
Well, TPP, I was called Governor No, and a lot of that legislation that I vetoed gave unfair advantage to intra.
You say first no to if you were to be president.
Well, I'm not going into this believing that I'm going to say no. Here's my hypothesis going in here is if you elect Trump or if you elect Clinton, I say things are going to be more polarized than ever. I mean, it's going to be worse than ever.
Specific to economic policy.
No new taxes, a certainty that any tax proposal that simplifies taxes or reduces taxes, I'm going to sign on to.
We are going to take a question from the audience next. But first, before we get to that audience question, I want to move to another topic, which you've spoken on a lot. And that has to do with gun ownership. Talk about those who are on watch lists and having access to
Johnson may be well on the watch list because there are a lot of Gary Johnsons. I mean, it's a possibility. And unlike Republicans that would say, look, the woman who has the abusive husband, she wants to go get a gun. I'm not saying she's going to get the gun to shoot her husband. I'm saying she wants to get the gun and the husband now knows. Well, assault, first of all, this is an educational kind of question, I believe. Automatic rifles are banned. If you talk about an assault rifle is a semi-automatic rifle, of which there are 30 million of them in the United States.
We are safer. We mitigate the horrible headlines of Orlando, of San Bernardino, when we have citizenry that are armed that can, if you will, the good people, help to fight the bad people. Agree or disagree?
Oh, I don't know. I mixed on that. But if you're one of those good guys, if you yourself are one of those to do, I'm back.
Had a gun?
Oh, gosh. A year ago.
How many guns you have?
I have a pistol, a 38 pistol, and I have a 12-gauge shotgun.
Question from the audience. We have two microphones here, and first down in the middle. Thank you for expediting your movement to the microphone.
Thank you. I'm Jinny Nguyen with Voice of Vietnamese Americans. Thank you, Governor Johnson. I like to bring back your support to the TPP because we strongly believe TPP merges the American values of human rights, protecting the environment, civil rights, and the free market, which is the foundation of our economic strength. So, and it's also based on the rule of law, which is the basic of our equality from the Constitution. So I'm asking you, based on the rule of law, would you say that the TPP has the same foundation as the global rule of law when we support the current UN verdict about the South China Sea, that the South China Sea belongs to international navigation rights to all of us to support the U.S. global leadership?
Thank you for your question. I appreciate that very much. There's a lot in that question,
Boy.
Governor. There were eight parts. You can take any part.
As President of the United States, I intend to honor and do we want to go to nuclear war over uninhabited islands in the South China Sea? I really don't.
Did he answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. We have another question from the audience. We'll get to that shortly. But I want to move to something that's the green stuff, marijuana. And you have been somebody that has been very much a thought leader on this space, shall we say. And as a thought leader on the policy that has been taken up across many states across the country, obviously the critique of marijuana access has been Colorado. And the headline that comes from that often is, we have seen the number of individuals hospitalized increase. The critics will say we're associating deaths with the access to marijuana. How do you answer those criticisms?
Well, just that they're really completely unfounded. Colorado is a vibrant place. 58% of Americans support legalizing marijuana. Laws would otherwise hope that you all would take that in the context of telling the truth. If you tell the truth, you don't have to remember anything, and I've been really well served by doing that. That said, I just don't think you should show up on the job impaired. Running for President of the United States is a 24/7 job. I'm not going to show up on this job impaired, and I've made
How was it?
Well, I don't want in any way to take away from a person's right to
right.
use these products. It was pleasant.
You're
getting the Federal Department of Education tens of thousands. No, from the standpoint of it should be more open than, you know, in support of allowing that?
So no.
Yeah, well, but expand it. Do away with it completely so that it's no longer a class, that we make immigration a lot easier.
DACA, deferred action for childhood arrivals, DACA. Yes or no?
Deferred action, yes. Okay. Meaning defer action, don't deport.
Question from the audience. We'll turn on the mic for you in just a second. Try it again.
Hello?
There you
Thank
go.
Thank you. So, Governor, one of the reasons why the Department of Education was set up and exists is in recognition that many states, in fact, were not adequately providing quality education to poor and minority children. So if you are going to get rid of the Department of Education, what are you going to do to ensure that, in fact, all states provide quality education to kids regardless of their race and their zip code?
Well, as all states have funding formulas, so the richest school districts don't receive more money than the poorest school districts. I mean, this has been court tested in state after state after state. And if you want to point out the fact that perhaps in certain instances, for example, refugees, immigrants that converge on a certain area because of circumstances, I think the federal government could play a role in easing that burden when it comes to educational costs. So I don't want to close the door on extraordinary circumstances that the federal government could play a role, but look, state after state, there's educational equal funding formulas.
All right, thank you so much.
Actually not.
Governor Johnson, we've got a minute left here. And I want to get a sense of, at least for our audience here, literally and virtually across the country in our 50 watch parties, is to understand what family means to you.
Well, family is everything. Family is everything.
Why is family everything?
Well, there's that unconditional love that goes along with family. And in my particular case, I have the two greatest kids of all time and space. I have a granddaughter. My parents are still alive. My father was actually landed in Normandy before D-Day with the 101st Airborne Division. What they instilled in me, what I'd like to believe I helped my kids. Mm-hmm. My kids haven't needed any help, but it's what I live for. My fiance Kate. It's my life. It is what I live for.
And finally, what did your father teach you?
What did my father teach me? I guess my father. I am on time to a fault. And also, just keeping your word, doing a little bit more for people than what you promise people, it's an amazing formula for success. I'm oftentimes asked, and I love the fact that somebody would think I was successful, but, you know, why have you been successful? Well, I show up on time, and I, you know what, to a fault, I tell the truth. You don't have to remember anything if you tell the truth.
Ladies and gentlemen, Governor Gary Johnson, nominee for the Libertarian Party.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you for the opportunity to be here. Richard, thank you. Thank you.
In 1975, I joined Dan Inouye, Spark Matsunaga, and Patsy Mink in Congress. A few years later, we were joined by Dan Akaka, Bob Matsui, and Robert Underwood. We made a difference for millions of people in our country. Patsy Mink led the effort on the passage of Title IX, which opened doors to women by prohibiting sex discrimination in education. Bob Matsui, Dan Inouye, Spark Matsunaga, and I led the efforts for the passage of the bill that apologized to Japanese Americans incarcerated during World War II and provided redress. Dan Akaka led the efforts on the passage of the apology resolution for the U.S. overthrow of the Kingdom of Hawaii. In 1994, we formed a caucus with this growing number of Asian American Pacific Islander members of Congress. We laid the groundwork for greater diversity in our government, so today the number of AAPIs in elected office are growing, and so is their leadership. As a result, Judy Chu was able to pass the resolution of regret for the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882. And this past year, Grace Meng and Maisie Hirono passed legislation eliminating derogatory terms in our laws relating to minorities. We came together to have a greater voice in D.C. and throughout the country. We learned from the lessons of the past to fight for a better future. When those making the decisions look like America, everybody in America benefits.
Today, there are 13 Asian American and Pacific Islander members of Congress, and our caucus has grown to 50 members. Collectively, we work to protect and advance the civil and constitutional rights of all Americans and establish policies on legislation and issues that reflect the concerns and needs of the Asian American and Pacific Islander community. We are proud that our caucus has continued the tradition that Norman Mineta started, and we look forward to new leaders of tomorrow. Today, we have a voice.
That video, of course, from the Congressional Asian Pacific American Caucus. Really a big voice, a growing voice on Capitol Hill and in Washington. And joining us is the chair of KPAC, Judy Chu.
Thank you, Joy Chen. And thank you, APIA Vote and the Asian American Journalist Association, for organizing the best APIA presidential town hall ever. As chair of the Congressional Asian Pacific American Caucus, or what we call KPAC, I'm proud to stand and see the largest gathering ever at the APIA town hall. 3,000 Asian American Pacific Islanders ready to engage in this critical election year for our community and our country. Just 2 weeks ago, at the Democratic National Convention, Asian Pacific Islanders reached a significant milestone when, for the first time in history, we in KPAC talked about who we were and how far we've come in front of the entire nation. You just saw the beginning of that video. There were 20,000 people in the arena that night. There were 23 million people watching the convention on television that night. And they were all able to listen to us tell our story. As chair of KPAC, I had the responsibility for our segment, which I hope you can see on YouTube later for its full 12 minutes. I wanted Americans to learn about the discrimination of the past and see the accomplishments of our pioneers like Dan Inouye and Patsy Mink. Most of all, I wanted to show how far we've come. Today, we have a historic high of 13 members of Congress that are AAPI. Yes. Many of them are trailblazers in their own right. And as the video that you just saw ended, the lights came on, and there on stage were all our AAPI Congress members. Each of them talked about their historic firsts. Congressmember Ami Bera talked about being the only South Asian in Congress. Mark Takano talked about being the first person of color to be LGBT in Congress. And me, I talked about being the first Chinese American woman elected to Congress in history. What I did not expect was the incredible support from those 20,000 people in the arena who were of all backgrounds and from every corner of the nation. They applauded warmly when the faces of pioneers like Norm Mineta appeared. And as each member introduced their historic firsts, afterwards, I didn't know that there was segregation, monarchy. And then there were the countless AAPIs from around the country who came up to me, teary-eyed and choked up, that our story was finally being told. For me, the moment was so powerful. In the past, AAPIs have been made to be invisible, to be ignored, and to be marginalized. But this is the case no longer. Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders are now the fastest growing racial group in the United States. We've doubled our voter registration numbers over the last decade from 2 to 4 million people. And by 2040, we will have doubled even those numbers. We are the swing vote in key swing states like Virginia, Pennsylvania, and right here in Nevada. In Virginia, when Senator Mark Warner was facing a tough re-election, he turned to the AAPI community They are 6% of the population, and he was able to get 68% of them to vote for him. Because of that, he won his race by less than 1%. Here in Nevada, Senator Harry Reid was facing a tough re-election, but he turned out to look to the AAPI community, which is 10% of this state. They supported him, and he came out on top. And that is why I say we have gone from being marginalized to the margin of victory. But in order to truly make a difference in this election cycle, we must know where our presidential candidates stand on the issues that matter most to us. And that's why today's presidential town hall is so important. AAPIs are 40% of the 4.3 million family visa backlog that is tearing families apart. That's why we have to know where our candidates stand on comprehensive immigration reform. We have Chinese American scientists whose lives have been nearly ruined with accusation of being spies for China, and then the charges totally dropped. We want to know what candidates will do to stop racial profiling. And South Asian, Middle Eastern, Sikh, and Muslim Americans are targeted simply for the way they look or the religion they practice. We want to know what candidates will do to stop the hate speech and present a true picture of the diversity of our country, a picture so eloquently painted by Gold Star father Khazir Khan of his Muslim American son who made the ultimate sacrifice for our country. The political rhetoric has become so toxic this cycle that we in the AAPI community cannot afford to sit on the sidelines. And regardless of which candidate you support or what your political affiliation may be, we know that violent and hateful rhetoric targeting AAPIs has no place in our society. But simply condemning these remarks is not enough. We must hold our presidential candidates accountable by exercising our right to vote. That means getting our community registered to vote. It means getting those who are already registered to vote to show up at the polls in November. And it means exercising the true power that we have as an Asian American Pacific Islander community to make a difference in this country. Together, let's make sure that AAPIs are the margin of victory in November 2016 and beyond. Thank you all very much.
Our thanks to the KPAC chair, Judy Chu. Thank you. So, as Judy mentioned, it is important to hold our leaders and would-be leaders to account, to ask them the tough questions. And as you heard, MSNBC's Richard Louie has no trouble posing tough questions and getting interesting answers. He rejoins us now with his next guest.
Thank you, Joey. Las Vegas, how are we doing right now? I got the shivers, I was a little teary-eyed when I was walking around a bit earlier, because we have four parties here to talk about running for the President of the United States. Here. First ever this cycle, and sitting next to me is the esteemed Dr. Jill Stein, the Green Party presidential nominee. So, Dr. Stein, thanks for being here. I know you've been all around the country as it is running for president. This is not the first time you've done this. Mm-hmm. Why do you want to do it again?
Well, we got some work to do. You know, I'm in this not just as a candidate, I'm in this as a mother, as a medical doctor, as a citizen of the planet. I am, are you hearing me okay? Just checking.
It's off and on. So maybe this is what we're going to do, Dr. Stein, because I don't want to miss a single iota. And what I've got here is the amazing microphone. There you go.
All right. Yeah, so why running again now in 2016? I'm here as a mother. I'm here as a medical doctor. I'm here as a citizen of the planet, very concerned about where we're going. In this race, we're not just deciding what kind of a world we will be, but even whether we are going to have a world or not going forward. Looking at the crisis of climate change, especially for the Pacific Islands and the Asian nations who are so much in the target hairs, especially not only the storms that are hitting the Philippines, but the sea level rise, and so much of the Asian nations are living on vulnerable coastlines, but also to look at these expanding wars that there is no end to, that both Democrats and Republicans continue to spend half of our discretionary budget, nearly half of your income taxes, on these wars which are not making us safer, which are actually making us less safe, creating failed states and mass refugee migrations and worse terrorist threats, or to look at the threat of nuclear weapons, which has been revived and which our current administration would spend $1 trillion on to create a whole new generation of nuclear weapons. So I'm here as an outsider. I'm the one candidate that does not take money from corporations, from lobbyists, or from super PACs. So I am the only candidate in the race that is free to actually stand up for what we, the people, need. And we need a new way forward based on democracy, justice, and human rights, not just in America. We need an America and a world that is working for all of us according to those same principles of justice.
So you've laid it out for us there. Thank you so much, Dr. Stein. How would you describe what the Green Party is in one sentence?
The Green Party is, again, the only party that's not taking that corporate money, the lobbyist money, and the super PACs. So the Green Party is the one party that can stand up for people, planet, and peace over profit and the future that we deserve.
You made the juxtaposition, the choice, this A versus B. We need to look at our defense budget. We need to put that stuff on this in this other bucket. You're talking about environmental policy. Why is it either or?
Exactly. You know, let me say, I think they all go together. We not only need a defense budget that's not an offense budget, but we also need an economy that's working for everyday people, and we need a climate that's here for the future. We can't just have one of them. They all have to go together. So I'm calling for a Green New Deal, like the New Deal that got us out of the Great Depression. But in this case, it's also a Green New Deal. So it both fixes the crisis of the economy at the same time that it fixes the crisis of the climate, creates 20 million jobs to transform our energy system to 100% clean renewable energy by 2030. That will create the jobs that we need to revive the economy and to make the wars for oil obsolete.
I love this stuff, but you know, it takes a couple of days to do what you just described here. If you look at Singapore as an example, you know, they've been trying to develop a similar technological advancement in their country, and it's taken decades. You look at Silicon Valley, and you look at the infrastructure, you look at the social, the human capital, as well as the physical capital, or if you will, the factories that need to be developed. How are you going to do this? This could take decades.
So I think the key thing here is to have a national leader who's actually telling the truth about, number one, the true emergency of the climate and the threat that it imposes, especially on low-lying nations and coastal population centers.
Sure.
But in addition, we need to tell the truth that we can actually do this by creating jobs. And, we've done this before. In the Second World War, for example, we mobilized in a heartbeat. It took us 6 months, in fact, to go from an economy that was not prepared for
but
that
Dr. Stein,
to one that was.
It took us decades to reap the benefits of that investment that you're talking about. It's, the welfare paradox. In this case, give me the first step you would make to develop this new industry, if you will, this new core competency that you want for America.
So it would be like having the New Deal during the Great Depression, which is another example of how we created millions of jobs when we recognized there was a national emergency. So the first step is actually creating millions of jobs and putting every American who wants a job back to work at a good wage, healthy job that's good for our communities, good for workers, and good for the planet.
How long will this take and how much will it cost? I'm sitting in Congress,
yes.
I gotta vote for this.
Here's the great thing. It actually pays for itself, believe it or not.
No, it cannot pay for itself.
Let me tell you how. Number one, it makes the wars for oil obsolete, so we can cut the military that is draining $1 trillion a year from our resources. So we cut the military and we put that into jobs. Our right to good, healthy, living wage jobs. And number two, I say this as a medical doctor, and I can give you countless studies to show it. We get so much healthier when we zero out the polluting fossil fuels, which cause cancer, which cause asthma, which cause heart attacks and strokes and all those things. The studies show we get so much healthier so quickly that our healthcare savings alone are also enough to pay the costs of this green energy transition. This is the good news they don't want you to know, because when people learn that we can actually do right by our climate, do right by our workers, and it pays for itself because we're getting healthy, it's just the win-win-win that we urgently need.
How do you get over this wrapper? Often when I introduce myself and they say, where'd you go to school? I went to UC Berkeley. And immediately they say, oh, no, I don't have my Birkenstocks on and I have not hugged a tree yesterday either. How do you react to that simplified idea of what you're talking about?
I find actually most people right now are really worried about the climate. They're also worried about the economy. And they don't know because the powers that be don't want you to know. They're trying to divide and conquer and keep us into separate warring camps. But the reality is that we can have the jobs and we can fix our environment all in one. I find it's all about getting to the microphone, because once I have a chance to actually get to the microphone, I find, number one, people can smell a rat. And if you're not on some corporate payroll, they can tell. So it's not hard to persuade people that there actually is the kind of way forward.
No. Because
I show, in fact, that most Americans are really demanding substantive and really Democratic National Committee, and between the Hillary Clinton campaign and between certain members of the big mainstream media that tilted the playing field against him, that characterized him as a mess, that tried to characterize him as an atheist before a religious demographics, and just really poisoned the water against him in so many ways, not to mention superdelegates to start with, that we're not accountable to the voters.
How are you going to get the Bernie Sanders vote then?
Well, they seem to be coming to me. When Bernie endorsed Hillary, that very night the floodgates opened into our campaign. Our donations went up 1,000%. People began flooding in as volunteers, helping with our ballot access
sure.
drive and the rest. So they are very well networked. That's a self-starter campaign, and they're getting the word out.
You brought up the point here, Dr. Stein, the value of earned media, the stuff that's out there that goes out for free. You know, by the way, after today, you got $500 million.
All right.
Yeah, that's what this is right here. But if you got to raise $1 billion, they say, or $1.5 billion, whatever it is, to be successful, and I'm just looking at that hill that you're telling me about. If you're way down here, that's a long way to go. I hope you got good hiking shoes.
Well, let me say that $1 billion creates politicians. They may be successful for them, but they're not successful for us. We need jobs. We need living wages. We have a whole generation of young people who are locked in student debt. We need to bail out the students. We bailed out the guys on Wall Street. How about we bail out a generation of young people? So what they did is not working for us. It's not working for our economies. It's not working for a generation that has no future, has no climate to, you know, to inherit the earth with. We can solve these problems, but they won't be solved, unfortunately, by political parties that are funded by the big banks, by the fossil fuel giants, by the war profiteers, by the insurance companies. We need a politics of integrity that's for the people. And let me just add one thing. There are 42 million young people, and not so young people, who are trapped in this student loan debt right now. 42 million people have only one place to put their vote. I'm the only candidate that will cancel that debt. 42 million is a winning plurality of the vote.
How will you pay for it?
Well, let me just say, we can pay for it the same way that we bailed out the banks. We created a thing called quantitative easing, big fancy language, but basically it means that the Fed can buy up that debt and then essentially cancel it digitally. So we have the capacity to do that.
But folks don't like that. They don't like that. That's not the right way to do it.
Well, some do.
Well, except for that
person. If they're in debt, I'll tell you. If they're in debt, they like it a lot.
The magic eraser is what you're saying. But folks don't like that. Critics
don't
like that.
Well, I'll tell you, the economists don't like it if you don't make the economy more productive. But what would make the economy more productive than liberating an entire generation to actually do their passion, to do the things that they've been trained to do, to use their skills to create the economy of the future?
Dr. Stein, you have never held public office before. We sit here next to each other as a very successful politician in many different ways, not only receiving the largest number of votes as a woman candidate for President of the United States. Not only is why you've been accomplished, but you've never run for office, you never held an office before. Actually, run for office, you've never held a public office before.
So actually, I have. I have been elected for two terms to my town's town meeting, like the legislative body for my town. So I actually have served in office, but I have, what shall we say? You know, I have worked inside of the system and I have worked outside of the system to get things done, to actually change legislation and to change regulation on behalf of everyday people. That includes cleaning up our toxic coal plants in Massachusetts. It includes shutting down our polluting incinerators, which were polluting, in fact, the fish supply, which was especially important to our immigrants, who are get money. We passed campaign finance reform as a referendum. So, and then unfortunately, the Democrats in the legislature repealed it. Social movements that have actually changed government for the better.
But the criticism is major public office. You know, we're looking at governors, you know, we're looking at those who have, you know, been members of Congress. And for some reason, that's the typical path.
Dwight Eisenhower actually did not serve in public office until he was elected president. And let me say, what I don't have is the experience of going behind closed doors and making secret deals. That's an experience I do not have and the American people do not want, and that would put us light years ahead, unfortunately, of the usual experience that most politicians bring to the table. So I would maintain that it's actually a great benefit to the public that I'm coming into office as an honest broker.
Based on economic data, many historians argue that during the New Deal, the economy didn't actually recover until we entered the war. In fact, Howard Zinn said in the first year of the New Deal, unemployment actually increased under the New Deal. So under your version of this plan, how would things be different, and how do you see the economy recovering against also, you know, a proposition to avoid getting into another war, for example?
Your name and where you're from.
Justin Ching, Los Angeles, Fox Sports.
Great.
They talk a lot about that stuff on Fox Sports, I guess. I don't know. It's,
all the time.
It's, don't let the name fool you.
So let me just say, I have never seen anywhere the claim that unemployment actually went up. Everything I have seen, the facts on the table actually show that employment went down, and rather quickly, within the first couple of months, millions of jobs actually were created under the New Deal. But you are right that the war effort was the final assistance to reviving the economy. And in a sense, what I'm calling for now is a wartime scale mobilization. But this is one that brings us together all around the world. We're not fighting each other. In fact, we've got to stop fighting each other. Our true clean, renewable energy of our urban so in a very definite direction in a global militarized, because we don't need to fight in the green
technology.
But especially
pick one. Just give me one.
Solar cells.
Yeah.
Community to afford that up.
Ethan, that we. And ask this.
Yep. Yeah, I'll say.
Do you have a diagram?
So I'd like to switch it to this community that's in the hall. Can you describe some of your own personal specific successes working with the Asian Pacific American community? And then also, how do you see inclusion in our community in your cabinet on the Supreme Court? How do you see that happening? Touching on a few of the subjects that to our heart.
Thank you for your question. First off, I have a question for you. What does AAPI stand for?
Asian American Pacific Islanders, of course.
You know, we were going to try to get a little bell that would go off, but we couldn't get that in time. Please, though, answer his great question there.
So, you know, I've been working with grassroots groups forever, including as a physician and a public health advocate. So the groups that I worked with to clean up our incinerators were based out of Lawrence, Massachusetts, one of the poorest communities in the nation, which has a very substantial population of Southeast Asian immigrants. And other immigrants as well. We worked together in a broad coalition to advocate to close down these very polluting incinerators that were poisoning the fish supply that the fishers of those community. You know, I think Asian country.
Let me bring it back though. This swing vote. They can swing outcomes in Ohio, North Carolina. We can look at Florida. We can look at Virginia. Hey, let's talk about Nevada, too.
It's huge. It's absolutely huge. It can make the critical difference. And I think what you're doing here today, empowering people for their vote to have an impact and also to hold candidates accountable, I think what you're doing here today, having invited the presidential campaigns to come and speak to you and to answer your questions, this is what model citizenship looks like, and I applaud you for doing that. In terms of...
Oh, you got them moving back
right,
here now.
Thank you.
I was wondering where they were... How's everybody doing back there, by the way? Take what you talked about, understanding the issues of diverse communities, and this is who you are. You cannot deny that it is part of what you have been. What is it like to be a woman and running for president in a country where when we You understand. Put those two together.
We need quality and $15. With the first dormitory, and it certainly took years that we had equal right to justice and to health and to education and all the rest. And it's not just women, it's all of our underserved and disenfranchised communities and ethnicities and
genders
exactly, and gender identities as well.
How important is it for men to be feminists?
Absolutely, yes, and I know plenty of them. And
where are they?
Come on board. Feminists, raise your hand out there. In my view, feminists are humanists. They all go together.
You got the crowd fired up over there. We've got a question right here on the right. Thank you so much for your question there, please.
And by all means, yes, an Asian American Supreme Court justice. It's time.
Oh, now you're just pandering to the audience. Come on.
Test me, okay?
Thank you so much, Dr. Stein. I appreciate it.
Hi, Dr. Stein. My name is Kevin Lee. I'm from San Francisco, California. I'm a proud Cal alum. Go Bears. Party's stance on immigration reform. What are your thoughts on that?
Great. Thank you for asking. So we've really been ahead of the curve on immigration reform. We support a welcoming path to citizenship and celebrating the immigrant members of our society. We are a nation of immigrants, with the exception of Native Americans and African Americans who were brought here under force. All the rest of us are immigrants in this nation, and we must celebrate our latest wave of immigrants who add to the diversity and the strength and the power of our nation. Specifically, we call for an immediate end to deportations, detentions, and night raids, which are a national scandal and should be stopped immediately. And we support a welcoming path to citizenship, recognizing that this crisis of immigration, or I should say, to put it another way, one of the most powerful things we can do to stop the crisis of immigration is to stop causing it in the first place through misguided economic policies, misguided trade policies, and the war on drugs as well, that do so much to destabilize other economies and other societies and force people to become refugees in order to have the security, the stability, and the opportunities that they deserve.
Thank you for your questions. I apologize. We have run out of time for the Q&A, and I thank you all for standing up for that. I want to finish with the question I asked Governor Johnson here. What does family mean to you?
Family to me means relationships. It means love. It means connection. And families are both biological. We're all born from a family. Some of us a physical family, but we're all part of a human family, in my view. We are connected to each other through our communities, our cultures, through our nations, and as one people on one small boat, which is planet Earth. And I think the immigrant community knows better than anyone else what it means to truly be a global citizen. And to me, we, within that framework, we are all part of the same human family, striving for human rights, for democracy, and for justice.
I have to ask this question because you and I talked about it, and they're telling me we got to get off the stage. But your parents, what did they teach you?
My parents taught me to have a spine and to stand up for what is right. I grew up in the generation after the Holocaust from an immigrant Jewish family. My grandparents were immigrants who had fled persecution. And I learned from them that we have to stand up for each other, that we have to stand together, and we have to stand up for what is right and for
Dr. Jill Stardi, presidential.
Thing called MTV, nobody. Wow. Rocking the vote. They rock the vote.
$80 million strong and have the potential to be the largest voting bloc in our country's history. That's an incredible amount of power. That's why we're really excited to team up with API Vote. Both organizations have a rich history of building movements and mobilizing the masses. So what we're doing here today is actually announcing our Power Up campaign. What we're doing is we're going to be working across industries. We have incredible support, and thank you so much to our supporters from entertainment, music, art, all around, and elected officials to make this the largest civic engagement campaign for API youth. So we're excited to power up and make history with you. Hi. Hi everyone, my name is Catherine. I'm the program associate for API Vote. So I wanted to give out some shout outs to our youth networks who are part of our youth campaign. So first is the East Coast Asian American Student Union, or ECASU. Woo! the Midwest Asian American Student Union, or MASU. NAPA, the National APA Panhellenic Association. See, I see some of y'all in the audience. ITASA, which is the Intercollegiate Taiwanese American Student Association. Y'all should be excited. These student organizations are here, and they're ready to help. And so we also have UNASFA, which is the Union of North American Vietnamese Student Association, and many, many more. And so these organizations are doing amazing work in their community, and we're working with them closely to get the AAPI youth to the polls and show everyone that Asian American Pacific Islander youth are a driving force to be reckoned with. So, yay!
Hello, I am Sarah Tabatabai, and I am the proud digital director of Rock the Vote. We are so thrilled to work with some of the largest names and public figures to excite young people where they are, online and on college campuses. Through interactive and impactful messaging, we're committed to making sure that the very real power of young people and young AAPIs is really heard and reverberating throughout the nation. But we need you. We need help from all of you. So I'm going to ask you to join those of us on stage and online by taking an action that we all do 50 times a day. So I'd like you to take out your phone, yep, take it out of your pocket, and open up your messaging app. So on text, you are going to write a message to RT Vote, and you can just type the letters right in. If you text the words power up to RT Vote to support our efforts to empower and energize young AAPIs to mobilize and get out this year, we can share exclusive updates and content with all of you. Together, we can be more.
Also the hashtag for today's forum. So we're gonna actually launch our campaign as we're launching it right now by doing a selfie with you all. So you better smile while we join the selfie. So we're gonna do this to launch our campaign.
We'll have to do two.
We'll do two.
You do it this way.
We'll just do
that. We'll do
that.
Go that way, I'll go this way.
All right, ready? I can be in both, watch.
It's like selfie-ception. Okay, ready? Get it.
Photo bomb.
Switch. Thanks, everyone.
Oh, no.
Yay, they did great. Can you believe that we didn't even have, selfies when. Anyway, I'm having a little trauma today, can you tell? The youth vote is really important this year, But it does go all the way back to those days in the 1990s, when our next speaker also found the power of a youthful vote. To introduce him is one of the leading figures in the APIA community who has a connection to our next speaker, and this is Gloria Kawili.
Sisters and brothers, my granddaughter has to hear this, so say, yay! Yay! You're right. This is all for her. Sisters and brothers, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, and that's all of you, members of the media, I am Gloria Kawili. All right, that was really sad. I am Gloria Kawili. My granddaughter heard it. And I am Filipino American. And I have the distinct honor today of introducing our 42nd president, William Jefferson Clinton. And as a proud Nevadan, a proud Las Vegan, I know that President Clinton believes that AAPIs will play a critical role in electing our next president, and not just across the country. So wherever, you know, you're surprised, Vegas, from your mind. APIAs, there's 177,000 eligible voters, which comprises 9% of the electorate. That's huge. Our voice, our votes. Our voice, our vote, will make the difference in this year's presidential, state, and local races throughout the country. You know, as one of the founders of APIA Vote, I, along with a lot of others in this room, envisioned that one day, presidential campaigns would take the time to be at the table with AAPI voters. And today is that day. Let me hear you like you believe it. You know, when President Clinton took office, he made good on his promise of making his administration look like America. During his tenure, he appointed the first Asian American to serve as cabinet secretary, Norm Mineta, for Commerce Secretary. He also appointed over 300 Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders in his administration. That ushered a generation of AAPIs in federal public service. In 1999, President Clinton signed the executive order creating the first ever White House initiative on Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders. You know, its mission was to improve the quality of life and opportunities for AAPIs by facilitating increased access to and participation in the federal programs. I had the honor and privilege as one of the founding commissioners of the White House Initiative. It was a great honor, and I was so proud. Thanks to President Clinton and to President Obama's continued commitment to AAPIs, the White House Initiative is alive and well. It continues to fight for the opportunities for Asian Pacific Americans, Pacific Islanders, Native Hawaiians, and immigrants and refugees. And Secretary Hillary Clinton, who has spent her life fighting for us, has committed to reauthorize the initiative and enhance its regional networks once reelected. On a more personal note, in my professional career, I served as special assistant to the president of the American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees. At an AFSCME convention, thank you, AFSCME members, thank you. At an AFSCME convention held in Chicago in 1998, President Clinton, who was our keynote speaker, unexpectedly announced prior to his speech that he wanted to ask me to come forward and be recognized 5 years that I had decorations on the wall. I saw secret. Matter of fact, the next
well, first, thank you. Soon will be known to every school child in America as Hillary Clinton's husband. But today, after that introduction, I think I should be known as the man who accompanied Grace Kawile to this convention. She did a great job, and I thank her very much. I want to thank Representatives Judy Chu, Dina Titus, and Mike Conda, who were with me backstage, who are longtime friends and colleagues, for their support and their work for Hillary. I want to thank Catherine Cortez Musto, who's, I know, been here a candidate for the Senate to succeed the great Harry Reid. Irene Bustamante Adams, the Nevada Assembly Leader, thank you. I want to thank the Asian American Journalists Association and the Asian and Pacific Islander American Vote, our hosts, for doing this. You know, this town hall is a little old-fashioned in a wonderful way. It proves that some of you may be newer Americans, but you represent the fabric, tradition, and values of this country better than some people who've been here a lot longer. And I mean that in the best sense. A democracy only really works when we talk to each other. When I think of my dream America in the 21st century, it includes an inclusive society where we value our diversity. And we've made so much progress in the last several years. As a nation, we clearly are less racist, sexist, homophobic than we used to be. Notwithstanding some unfortunate incidents in this campaign, most Americans are not bigoted against other people because of their religion. But we do have one remaining problem. And you see it the way we self-select everything from the television talk shows we watch to the neighborhoods we live in. We don't seem to want to be around anybody who disagrees with us anymore. And that makes it hard to have a democracy. If you read the American Constitution, it might well have been subtitled, "Let's Make a Deal." Because there are three branches of government, and there's the federal, state, and local levels. We have constitutional rights embodied in the Constitution that have to be interpreted by courts. They have to decide what deference to afford legislative bodies, including the Congress. We were set up as a country that could never become a dictatorship. And now, the long-term crisis going prosperity with rising poverty to do it. The Republicans would, of course, say we just have to double down on trickle-down economics. If only we cut taxes enough on upper-income people and deregulated the economy, everything would be hunky-dory. And we, I thought, should say that the problem all over the world today is very slow growth. And when interest rates are lower than inflation, the important thing to do is to give people confidence and to invest, to build potential for the future that would empower people to make the most of their lives and give their children better tomorrows. All that's really important. I'm proud to be here to speak on behalf of Hillary and her running mate, Senator Tim Kaine from Virginia, one of the most admirable people in American public life, and one of only about 30 people in the history of the country who has been a mayor, a governor, and a United States senator. So he knows how America works. So I think they've done a really good job of coming out with the best ideas on economics. Yesterday in Detroit, Hillary laid out her economic plan to create more and better jobs and help more people fill those jobs and to accelerate the formation of small businesses, something very important to the Asian American and Pacific Islander Americans. For the last 20 years, two-thirds of our new jobs have come from small business. But in the aftermath of the crash, lending became much more difficult, particularly lending in more modest numbers. So that in the last few years, notwithstanding the fact that we're still growing jobs more in President Obama's second term than any other advanced economy in the world, our small business formation is not picked up, and we are no longer in the top five countries in the world in the formation of new businesses. That has been the lifeblood of the Asian American and Pacific Islander community for as long as you have been coming to be a part of America's diverse quilt, and we've got to do something about it. So when she says, we're going to change the bank rules for community banks, credit unions, make it possible to give more small business loans, we're going to dramatically increase activity with the Small Business Administration and the Small Business Investment Company to accelerate the formation and expansion of small business. We're going to focus on minority and women-owned businesses. I know that will work because we did it in a more normal economy in the 1990s, and a lot of you got your start then, and the small business sector exploded. We need to bring more manufacturing jobs back to America, but they can't be yesterday's jobs. They need to be tomorrow's jobs. There is, in Indiana, for example, a German-owned Mercedes-Benz plant making Mercedes, 100% of which are being purchased for $130,000 each in China. You can make anything in America. Labor every year is a smaller cost of production. Materials, energy, and transport are, relatively speaking, larger costs. We can build a whole new modern manufacturing economy, and we should be about it, because every manufacturing job creates two and a half other jobs in the economy. We do need a major infrastructure program with public and private capital, because investments in infrastructure return almost $2 in economic growth for every $1 invested in better roads and rails and ports and airports and cleaner water systems. The children of Flint, Michigan are by no means the only Americans who have elevated lead levels in their blood. And we could create a huge number of good jobs. Americans are still Native Americans, live on reservation lands in a major city. They're in small towns, anybody open a new business, where they once had? Well, because of climate change. United States, if we're going to be one country, and I want to emphasize that, because that's a big choice in this election. Are we going to be one country? I want your distinctive needs addressed. I want your distinctive opportunities seized. But you want a president like Hillary who sees you as part and parcel of the American quilt of diversity, part of a whole country that is stronger together. But we should do something for them. There should be more tax incentives for people to invest their money in areas that have been left out and left behind. Every American should have access to affordable broadband by 2020. Think of it. There are still 5 million kids who get homework that require them to do research on computers who don't have any access to the internet. And there are whole places that overnight could put their ingenuity and skills to work in the national economy and eventually in the global economy if they were just part of the virtual global economy. So there's plenty to do to build an inclusive economy where we're stronger together. I think there are things we have to do to make an inclusive society, to tear down the barriers to people participating. Hillary has talked about this since the day she announced for president. You can have a good economic policy, but if some people are shut out of it, it won't matter. We need to open the doors of opportunity for everyone, beginning with making sure that you get a decent education no matter what zip code you live in, investing more of scarce federal dollars and making teachers better teachers. I'll give you an interesting example since I'm before this group. Last year and the year before, an international rating agency said the best really big city school system in the world was Shanghai. So I started doing my research, and I came across an interview with the superintendent of schools. He sounded like somebody I grew up with. You know what he said? I didn't. When I became a really good principal, so instead, I spent 3 or 4 years improving their skills. Once we did that, the best teachers and principals and send them to the lowest performing schools. Then, a few years after that, they said we had the best big city school system in the world. I don't know. All I did was to take advantage of the fact that every teacher wanted to be a good teacher, every principal wanted to be a good principal, and most everybody can learn and do what needs to be done to develop the imagination of our children. I thought, where has that guy been all my life? And interestingly enough, in the United States, the state of Massachusetts in 1992 started trying to do that. Now, those of you who don't live there might be saying, oh, don't insult my intelligence. They got Harvard, they got MIT. What are you talking about? They also have a lot of first-generation immigrants. They have a lot of low-income people. They have a lot of children in their schools whose first language is not English. But if you look at their performance on international exams, if they were a separate country, they'd have the 8th best school system in the entire world, because they focus on making teachers better teachers, making principals better principals, and involving the community and the families in the life of the school. Hillary wants that for every kid in this country. And she also has proposed a plan to make college tuition free at public colleges for every family with an income of $125,000 or less, and to make it possible for every young person to graduate from any college debt-free, with special emphasis on the public and the private schools that serve a disproportionate number of first-generation Americans and Americans from more modest incomes. And then, maybe most important of all in the short run, to lift the burden of college debt off of young people. And this is really important. One of the reasons our small business formation rate has slowed down is that there are too many young millennials who owe so much money, they have no credit rating, they can never get a small business loan. Not very far from here, during the primary election, I visited a vegan restaurant in old Las Vegas, opened by a young African-American entrepreneur. And I asked her how she got the money to open the restaurant, and she described it. Same way a lot of you opened your businesses. All the families helped, the friends helped, or whatever. But we got to have a country where you can get a bank loan, where the dreams of the future don't die in the parking lot. And Hillary has laid out a very specific plan to make it easier to get small business loans and not as costly for the banks to give them as it is for them to process requests for $8 million or $80 million loans. This is an important thing to do to build the future of the economy. But it's more important to make sure young people can take advantage of it. The unemployment rate today in the United States for people with college degrees is 2.4%. That means two things. It means for people, there are nevertheless more than 1 million jobs open for plumbers, welders, pipe fitters, other kinds of jobs that would pay a middle class earnings income, but people aren't trained in the areas where the job openings are. So Hillary wants to emphasize apprenticeship and training programs in corporations and by unions and give people tax incentives to do it, to redignify skills training and to move people into openings much more quickly. It could make a big difference, particularly in some places in the country. And then she believes that we need comprehensive immigration reform as an economic strategy as well as something that is socially right. You just got to decide whether you think it's good or bad for us to have the youngest, most workforce in the world. I think it's our great meal ticket to the 21st century. There is someone here from everywhere. And our diversity gives us an, basically almost irresistible mix of creativity and unlimited potential. She favors automatically giving a green card to every person who comes here seeking a master's or a PhD, so that if they want to stay here and contribute to our future, they get it. She favors immigration reform because there are too many families that still worry every single day about whether they're going to be broken up. A not insignificant percentage of them are Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders. And we should care about them. She supports the executive actions the president has undertaken and will continue to defend and implement them. But she has also said that within her first 100 days, she would present a new comprehensive immigration reform bill that will give people a path to citizenship. And look, I just want to say this as plainly as I can. If you wasted the money to round up and deport every undocumented person in this country, you would disrupt millions of families, and along with the heartbreak, it would drive this country into a recession. We need people who are working hard, taking care of their kids, trying to be part of the fabric of America. We have played politics with this issue long enough. We have pretended that it was something it's not long enough. And she is determined to bring some stability, sanity, and future orientation to this issue. We ought to be growing together. Now, there are other problems. 40% of the visa backlog in America are requests from Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders. Some people in the Philippines have been waiting for more than 20 years for a visa. When I was president, one of my many, not M-A-N-Y, M-I-N-I, one of the things that I was really proud of that I was able to do is to make my Filipino-American doctor in the Navy, Dr. Connie Mariano, the first female admiral of Asian American and Pacific Islander heritage in history. This is crazy. So we need to do something about this. But as it turned out, all the things that I took for granted, the White House executive order that set up our Conference on Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders. One of the happiest moments of my presidency was late in my second term when I was able to give the Congressional Medal of Honor to a lot of Asian American and Pacific Islander soldiers whose service had been overlooked and whose records had never been examined, including the great Senator Dan Inouye of Hawaii. Now we have a bigger question, because the premise of all of Hillary's economic arguments, all of her social arguments, her political arguments that we should protect and expand voting rights, not restrict them, that in an internet like nets and walls, the only way to prevail is through cooperation that produces inclusive prosperity, inclusive societies, inclusive politics, and inclusive national security policies that gets other people around the world and in our country to work with us. The American people, therefore, in this election will be called upon to decide something even more important than economic policy or social policy or any discrete issue. In 8 years is your my life. Our cooperative solution. Being mad to them, it may be good politics in the short run, but good things do not happen. So I want you to think about that. You can have a big impact on the vote in Nevada, Pennsylvania, and other swing states. But you ought to show up big time everywhere for the local elections and the state elections and the federal elections. Because every time you do, you remind people that a pluribus unum is not just a slogan, it's a way of life. You remind people that the eternal effort to make our union more perfect means expanding the definition of us and shrinking the definition of them, not the other way around. And therefore, the metaphor of this election may be walls or bridges. Are we stronger together or stronger apart? The nearest terrorist incident to where you're sitting most recently was the horrible carnage in San Bernardino. You can put up all the walls you want. Those people weren't converted by physically transporting themselves to ISIS land. They were converted over the internet. A distinguished American military veteran, Admiral Jim Stavridis, who now runs the Fletcher School at Tufts, and a Greek American, was on television the other day saying, "You know, I love the military. I was honored to wear our uniform. There actually are two or three areas where we need to strengthen our budgeting and increase our capacity. But I want my fellow Americans to know we are not going to kill our way out of this security challenge. We're going to educate and argue and work and live our way out of it by proving that our diversity is a blessing, that we can live together, that our differences make it possible to have a different kind of union, and we are all needed. I think that's why so many military and national security experts that were heavily involved with Republican administrations have bolted their party to endorse Hillary, because they know that she can keep us safer and give us the space we need to grow our economy, and in so doing, to lift the world's economy to a better place. I spent a lot of my life arguing this. I went to Vietnam last year for the 20th anniversary of the normalization of our relations. We fought a long and bloody war. Now we don't have a stronger ally in Southeast Asia. I go back to Cambodia where I can, where my foundation discovered an orphanage full of children with AIDS before medicine was widely available, and got it to them. And I keep up with a little boy who I held in my arms at 9 months old. Both his parents had AIDS, and they were both already dead by the time he was 9 months old. He's a healthy, growing boy now. And the whole world is better because more of those kids are alive today. I know that the headlines are all grabbed by the bad things that happened. But the truth is, we live in a world that is interdependent. That's just a fancy word for saying divorce is not an option. And therefore, the only sensible proposal is to maximize the positive aspects and minimize the perils of the interdependent world. Hillary's the best qualified person to do that at this time in the United States of America, based on the life she's lived, the service she's rendered, the things and the people she knows. That is my belief. But it is for you to decide. If you ask me, well, why should somebody vote for Hillary and Tim Kaine, I'd say, well, they got the best economic program, and I know something about that. They've got the most ambitious program to finally treat women equally with men, to lift wages, to have inclusive family policies like affordable child care and paid leave. We're one of only seven countries in the world that doesn't have paid leave. That should be embarrassing to you as an American. We should do something about it. The most important job of every society is raising children. We dare not set up an economy where you have to choose between succeeding at work and succeeding at the most fundamental job of any society. So I could talk about that. I could say this is a very important time for national security. You need somebody who served on the Armed Services Committee with great distinction, who served as Secretary of State, who had an unprecedentedly close relationship with the Secretary of Defense and the military establishment, something that's not always happened. And somebody who always prefers peace to war, but understands that if you build a world with bridges instead of walls, you still have to have security checks. So I want you to think about that. I never dreamed when this election started that by this point I'd do anything more than argue about who's got the best trade plan, who's got the best investment plan, who's got the best. This is about what kind of country we're going to be. About whether you and everybody else who lives here can feel at home in America. If you can, I believe the chances are far greater than 50-50 that the next 30 years will be a period of enormous prosperity, broadly shared, rising mobility, declining inequality, and it will be leading the world away from people who think life and meaning in life will come from murder, toward those who think meaning in life comes from helping themselves, their families, and their neighbors. That's the great gift your community has given to America so far. Now it's a gift we have to give back to ourselves and to the larger world. Thank you very much.
Voice of for all for us workers, your president. Same time, you are us, and you've been. You think leadership by building our education and exports. All the trends. Gold standard. Secretary of Defense Ash Carter said the TPP is more than any carriers in the South China Sea. Would you support the TPP? And would you make the differences between the TPP? Thank you.
I'd like to consequences and of the bill we that is jobs that are doing well in America in our trade and that is becoming and in terms of jobs and they're very by very large shareholders who want quick returns and pay their CEOs based only on the share price. Almost all Asian companies are stakeholder companies. And I'm complimenting them now, not criticizing them. That is, they're only too happy to trade that they should actually close down an operation in the mother country and move it to someplace else. I have an American friend who owns a company in Japan. He said, now, in my company in Japan, if I open a plant in Vietnam to serve Southeast Asia, they will give me a plaque and say, good for you. But if I shut down the plant that was in Japan, Vietnam, the country, and I wouldn't be able to do business there anymore. In other words, all these trade deals, particularly those that do not deal with currency valuation changes, are being viewed with a different, more skeptical eye in the United States by many people, in part because our companies themselves are no longer stakeholder-based. And as you know, I signed 300 such trade deals. I was very much in favor of more trade. But I really understand why there's so much resistance now, particularly to multinational trade agreements rather than country-by-country agreements where you can go through more specifics, because the working people of America have seen too many American corporations use the trade deal not just to put operations in other countries to put people to work and sell to them there, or to buy products into our country, which we should do in a fair trade thing, but to actually shut down plants in America and move them to other countries to send the goods back to this country, something that China doesn't do, something that Japan doesn't do, something that Korea doesn't do, and it reflects relatively well on them, and hardly any European country will do this. So, particularly with the currency issue unaddressed, is that we live in a country where right now we don't have enough stakeholder-driven corporations, too many are shareholder-driven, and therefore she believes that there's no way, given the number of things that are not covered in this agreement, even though the labor standards are higher, that's true. The environmental standards are higher. Country products. For employing us that you're before. That I'm saying companies operate better. Our companies for other things. Problem. Go ahead. There you go. I would stay. Go ahead. Wait a minute. That's it. It's not true.
And if it, okay, but how do you explain the American people who believe she lies? How do you explain?
First of all, with the FBI director. First of all, the FBI director said, when he testified before Congress, he had to amend his previous day statement that she had never received any emails marked classified. They saw two little notes with a C on it. This is the biggest load of bull I ever heard that needed to make. And the State Department typically puts a little C on it to prevent the Secretary of the National Security Union. Security agencies, career diplomats, whom are careless, advisor Admiral Scowcroft have endorsed Hillary. Would General Colin Powell's assistant at the State Department have endorsed Hillary? Would the CIA, and had said he'd never declared party and had voted for Republicans as well as Democrats, have endorsed Hillary? You should ask them. Would everybody who's ever worked with her before, if she were not trustworthy? I had a man who was the head of a country, who actually was that it was a mistake, and her successor, John Kerry, did for a year until it was no longer legal for her. But that's what I would say. I think people in should be would have endorsed her, and like I said when I spoke at the convention, if you got the friends of your lifetime, if people you went to elementary school with are still campaigning for you, if you haven't lived in Arkansas since 1993, and hundreds of people at their own expense went all over America to campaign for you. If the people that work with you in every walk of life, and then people who know you in your official capacity, all have good things to say. The thing I would say is a lot of negative publicity and people don't know about you, it hurts you. But I'm just telling you, there are people who spent their lifetime advancing the national security who believe she's the only person left you can trust with it. Thank you very much.
I got a feeling that tonight's gonna be a good night, that tonight's gonna be a good night, that tonight's gonna be a good, good night. I'm feeling, that tonight's gonna be a good night, that tonight's gonna be a good night, that tonight's gonna be a good, good night. Tonight's the night, let's live it up. Spin it up, go out and smash it, like oh my god, jump out that sofa, let's kick it off.
I know that.
Would anybody like to know who has the toughest job in this room? Is there any, like, doubt about that? Because, like, I just had to ask the former leader of the free world to move along. That went great. Awkward. Yeah. Okay. But you know what? He was just the warm-up act. Right? We got work to do here. We have voices to hear from. And one of the voices who has been most prominent in speaking for and to our community is my friend Congressman Mike Honda. Come here, Mike. Gotta put you to work. Mike Honda from Silicon Valley, a leader for KPAC for many years, and a great voice for Asian Pacific Americans. Yeah, it's nice you got that warm up from that guy.
The hardest job following the greatest leader of the free world, Joey. Well, at least you guys got to stand up and, you know, relax a little bit and get your blood flowing. And so I just want to ask you guys, if I say API vote, I'd like you to say power up. You got it? You do it three times. API vote. API vote. API vote. All right. Good. This is what we're all about. And I just want to thank the sponsors and everybody that was on the chart up there for co-sponsoring. If you look at this room, if you look at this room and you saw us two sessions ago, it would have been a major difference. And here's to come together mediation. Let's more involved in the Coliseum together. Members of the LGBTQ community. And most importantly, we represent the diverse AAPI community from throughout this nation in our territories. I just want to throw in a plug for Joey Chen and Richard Louis. Aren't they doing a good job? Here's my message. You should be looking at when you moderate not only the presidential candidates, but the whole world. We have to vote, to learn about the issues, and to get out the vote for November 8th. We have a long-term goal also that will go on until we get every eligible voter out to vote, 100% registered to vote. We know that those registered to vote, about half actually vote. We have to improve those numbers, and there are no excuses. And what do we need to do tomorrow? After we listen to the candidates and their campaigns address our AAPI community today, I urge you to get involved in the partisan or nonpartisan efforts. I know that almost all of you already are the leaders working tirelessly on the ground to empower our community. Have your communities trained by organizations like API Vote so we can increase our reach. And stress that not voting is not an option, is not what democracy is all about. It's not empowering the AAPI community. Help provide in-language assistance at the polls through phone calls and your presence, and serve as poll monitors. Be present at the polls with your friendly faces. Remember, democracy is not a spectator sport. We have to go for the gold medal and go for the 100% turnout of Asian American Pacific Islanders. We have finally caught the attention of the media that the AAPI electorate is able to swing elections. Let us prove to them once again that AAPIs are concerned, loyal Americans who are expressing their beliefs in the American dream just like every other American voter. Now remember the stats. We have 6 swing states in their districts. We have 31 swing districts, swing congressional districts that could make a difference. And every day, 7,000 17-year-olds are turning 18. So what do we do and what do we say? AAPI vote? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Congressman Honda. We have promised that we would hear from all four of the campaigns, the leading campaigns, and so we invite as well Donald Trump's campaign to send a representative. And joining us from supporting Donald Trump is the Utah Attorney General. Sean Reyes is the highest ranking law enforcement officer of Filipino origin in the United States working today, and he is speaking on behalf of his candidate, Donald Trump.
Thank you. Before I begin, ladies and gentlemen, I need to take care of a critical item of business, so if you will indulge me for just a moment. Okay, this side, get your photo bomb on. Terrific. Thank you, thank you. And thank you, Joey, for the introduction. Let me start by saying this afternoon, aloha.
Aloha.
Kind of weak. So the idea is I say it and then you say it back with some spirit. So let's try it again. It's not political. It's just a greeting. Aloha.
Aloha.
Very nice. Now, how about this one? Mabuhay. Okay, right there. Asian worldwide. To be able to, regardless of your political stripes or where you are on the political spectrum, work towards having more of a voice for Asian American Pacific Islanders. So again, it is a pleasure. I want to thank you. Some caveats, though, because I am a lawyer, so they're obligatory. The first caveat is we have so many acronyms. So there's AAPI, APIA, APA, and in an effort to just be as succinct as possible, I'm going to say APA without trying to offend anybody. You want to debate that later on, we can. You can file a grievance and we can work on that. Number two, I hate politicians, which might come as a surprise to you because I'm a public elected official, but let me tell you why. Definition of politics, any of you heard this before? Comes from two root words. So the etymology, two cognates. The first being poly, which means what?
Amen.
Ticks, which are little blood-sucking, I think, as I'm defining them, of politics for me and that it represents. And I do want to say that we have a lot of public servants, people that I admire, on both sides of the aisle, Democrats, Republicans, those of other affiliations in the APA community, and I want to pay tribute to them. Many of them in my state were the pioneers who opened doors for me to be able to be the first minority elected statewide official in our state's history, and without them and their courage and valor, again, across party lines, I wouldn't be here representing you or my state as the Attorney General. Now, the last caveat that I want to make is Pacific Island audience, largely. And it sure looks like one, but I want to do one little test. This is not stereotyping. This is just me sharing some of my life experiences, and I'm going to invite you to resonate with. If you've ever eaten Spam on... Now, clap, speaking of rice, if you measure the ratio of rice to water using the finger or knuckle method ever. Thank you. You clap if you or your family have ever come back taped up. Clap on that one. Come on. I know you islanders out there, especially the Pacific or the Balikbayan boxes. I know those. And finally... I'm going to cut these short in the interest of time. Clap if you have ever thought with you today, you who are leaders in the Asian Pacific American community, whether you're first gen or multi-gen, recently arrived or well-settled, Republican, Democrat, or other, your sacrifices to come to this country, to be the first to attend college in your family perhaps, to be the fourth generation of valedictorian and run the family business, the sacrifices to make our communities better, to raise strong families, build thriving companies, all of these sacrifices and efforts have not gone unnoticed by Donald Trump or the Republican Party. You are such a critical strength to our nation, and your influence as leaders in the APA community and ability demographic, as we all know, is growing rapidly. of recent immigrants, and Pacific Islanders are growing in numbers and influence as well. The contributions by APAs to America are enormous. In business, the arts, journalism, technology, science, academia, law, medicine, film, cuisine, literature, policy, government, I could go on and on and on. Donald Trump appreciates these significant contributions. He said nationwide. He's an APA, not a headliner like others who've preceded me on the stage, but I think Trump and Governor Mike Pence. And that is the fact that they would allow an average person like me to be able to speak to a group as important as you. I think it speaks to the emphasis that they've made on protecting the average American. And by the way, I want to thank the Secret Service for finally giving me clearance to actually come out on stage and speak. Thank you. Guys. General. Many of them say, well, okay, now we know. I don't know, what are you had when the Pokemon and I say, but usually I think they're asking about when they say, what are you, my heritage? So, in case any of you were wondering, I gave you a little clue with the initial greetings. My mother, who I just lost last year, was half Japanese and half Native Hawaiian. On her Japanese side, she was a Maeda from Clan Maeda. Her grandfather, called Do What I Say. Her first language. Filipino street cred, yes. I can. After and an evolution, you know, my almost 50 years in his 20s, his beloved homeland of the Philippines. And it was a mere decade or so before that his godfather, it was really his cousin, but he called him uncle, Ramon Magsaysay, great president of the Philippines, had brought the Philippines to a great point in its history. My dad also himself had experienced a lot of success, toured singing with radio and TV show, had been a line producer for MGM at the age of 15. President who rose to his safety. He kept kids be born. He said his greatest day was becoming an American citizen. As a small business owner struggling to make ends meet in Los Angeles and raise a small family, he felt the Republican Party helped him the most. He felt that they were the most compassionate party, the most fiscally sound, the most conducive to family values and principles of hard work and self-reliance, and he became a Republican. Was born, again, when she graduated from college and began a 40-year career in education, she was still surrounded by many friends who were Democrats. But she became disenchanted with a union-dominated system that seemed not to be a meritocracy, where entitlements that enabled rather than empowered and tax and spend policies by state and federal Democrats made her finally say, enough. She joined the Republican Party. And so I became a Republican at a very early age. 1 year old, I had Richard Nixon pajamas on. But like my family, going back to my mom and dad, I think people today, traditions and paradigms, I want to get into some hard facts. 2% growth, the weakest so-called recovery since the Great Depression. Increase of nearly Americans. Home ownership is at its lowest rate in 51 years. Nearly 12 million have been added to the food stamp rolls since President Obama took office, and another nearly 7 million Americans were added to those ranks, or to the ranks of those in poverty. We have the lowest labor force participation rate in four decades. 58% of African American youth are either outside the labor force or not employed, and 1 in 5 American households do not have a single member in the labor force. Now, these are the real unemployment numbers. The 5% figures that they bandy about, Those are some of the biggest hoaxes in modern politics. Meanwhile, American households are earning more than $4,000 less today than they were 16 years ago. The average worker today pays 31.5% of their wages to income and payroll taxes. And on top of that, state and local taxes consume another approximately 10%. Similarly, the U.S. has the highest business tax rate among the major industrialized nations of the world at 35%. It's almost 40% when you factor in taxes at the state level. In other words, we punish companies for making products in America, but let them ship products into the U.S. tax-free if they move overseas. Now, let me tell you about Donald Trump's approach to the economy and his vision. He will revamp our economic policy to ensure that all Asian Pacific Americans can achieve the American dream. He will provide tax relief to middle-class Americans and increase take-home pay, streamlining and simplifying the tax code to ease the burden on APAs and all Americans. Our current trade policy allows countries like China and Mexico to take American jobs. Mr. Trump believes in restoring jobs which have been outsourced to foreign countries to ensure that every American, including every Asian Pacific American, can have a well-paying job. He will close the tax code loopholes that corporations have exploited to dodge taxes. For too long, America has been losing to foreign interests, but no more. Mr. Trump believes in America first, no exceptions. Now, another thing that I'm impressed about, Mr. Trump's vision for the economy, he will rein in federal regulators who put more and more burdens on Asian Pacific American small business owners, from convenience store owners, nail salons, restaurant owners, to those who offer professional services like doctors, lawyers, and accountants. These federal agencies are run by unelected, unaccountable bureaucrats who have created a fourth branch of government. They've never owned a small business. They've never run one. They've never sacrificed to start one or to make payroll or take care of their employees. Yet they create laws without congressional approval, making it much more difficult to get needed capital to start and run a business, and forcing small Asian Pacific American businesses to pay more for health care, overtime, and taxes. These administrative laws number in the tens of thousands. I think the Federal Register is over 80,000 pages of these additional administrative laws passed outside, again, the purview of Congress, burdening the everyday American and the small business owner. Some estimates are that these federal overregulations cost our country $2 trillion a year. Donald Trump will put an end to this unconstitutional burden being laid on the backs of hardworking, taxpaying, law-abiding Asian Pacific American business owners. Now, without the burden of overregulation, small businesses can flourish. And let me be clear, small businesses, they are the heart and soul, the lifeblood of our economy. Just yesterday, I penned a letter of support for the Pacific Island Business Alliance in Utah, praising them for building a community of support and sharing resources. In Hawaii, the spirit of kokua, or support, is not just a superficial one. It's almost a sacred duty to help your neighbors, to pay it forward, to give back. Not reliant on government, but reliant on themselves and each other to succeed. Government can be a catalyst, but not the answer to every problem. That is what Donald Trump believes, putting money back in your pockets and into your businesses and lessening government interference is one way that we will make the American economy grow again. Now, when it comes to education, Donald Trump understands the APA's community, the community's need for high quality education, and that education is a student's ticket to the American dream. He understands moms who sacrifice so much and expect so much. My mom once grounded me for an entire summer, minus, and I'll do that again, but I had the great desire to better our lives and our communities through education. Common Core, which the Democrat Party continues to push for, has taken control of education. To choose whether that's public, which drives high standards and ensures that students are attending the best schools possible. More freedom. Mr. Trump firmly opposes race-based standards imposed by affirmative action programs, which limit the potential of APA students and job seekers. Now, you know and I know well that APAs are often discriminated against by affirmative action programs. When I was at the University of California, Berkeley for law school, there was a joke that the acronym for our sister school at UCLA was underrepresented Caucasians lost amongst Asians. And that has had that perception or that reality a negative impact on admissions for well-deserving, hardworking Asian students. Let me share with you an example of more diversity, which I think is a tremendous aspiration. Diversity is definitely a good thing, and we can agree on that. Republicans embrace diversity. But without affirmative action, when I took office just a few years ago, women and minorities in leadership were highly underrepresented. Rather than targeting a particular quota or implementing an affirmative action plan, I fired everyone, let everyone apply who thought they had enough talent, regardless of the letter next to their name politically, regardless of their religious background in a very religious state, regardless of who they know, difference, who is the most dedicated. And lo and behold, once we made our hires, they had a chance to prove that they were the best. We gave them that opportunity. And I know Mr. Trump agrees with that approach. To ease the burden, finally, of student debt, he will not allow the federal government to profit from student loans. Now, let me take a moment to talk about health care. It was raised earlier several times by the other candidates or proxies. Donald J. Trump will fully repeal and replace the Obamacare burden, which has driven up health care costs across the country and has not improved the quality of care for average Americans. Less freedom. A Trump administration will allow insurance companies to compete in a free market across state lines. Competition will decrease costs and increase quality of care. Once more freedom. Mr. Trump will promote tax-free health savings accounts and allow individuals to deduct health care payments from their tax returns. To better provide for low-income APAs and their health care needs, Mr. Trump will give control of Medicaid to the states which are best equipped to administer these services. More freedom. For our APA veterans, Mr. Trump believes in fixing the broken VA system and paying private doctors to ensure that our heroes, and he truly believes that our military men and women are heroes, that they will receive the proper treatment they deserve for defending our country. If you want to clap, you can clap as loud as you want right there. So some timid claps. To improve the affordability of prescription drugs, a Trump administration will reduce barriers to entry to a free market for manufacturers of pharmaceuticals. Donald Trump understands the importance of America's safety and protecting our APA communities. Under the Obama and Clinton foreign policy, America's national security has been compromised, and I don't think there's any way around that. I think no matter how you spin that, that is the reality of how the world is and how we are perceived. Radical Islam has become an international plague, and many innocent lives have been lost. Again, I'm talking about radical Islam, not law-abiding, God-fearing, Muslim neighbors and friends. We're talking about a specific subset who are terrorists. And I spent yesterday time with a governor from an allied nation. A few weeks ago, several attorneys general from another nation. And it was their perception. They were worried for us. They said, Sean, America is still great, but America is not perceived to be strong anymore. And that worries us for you, and that worries us for us, because if America, we, your allies, our efforts against terrorists. We can ensure that the American homeland is kept secure. We will secure our borders to ensure that all Asian Americans can prosper in a safe country free from criminal organization, human trafficking, 20 to 40 million estimated modern-day slaves for the victims, the survival, health, emotional, have from being a couple points of American workers, including Asian Pacific American workers, first. And abuse, and we have to, as a law enforcement community, to make sure that the community are tremendous public servants who don't deserve the invective and the rhetoric that has been hurled their way. Mr. Trump stands behind our men and women in uniform who every day run towards danger while we run away from it. Again, their safe return. This rampant, we must work criminal justice reform, dealing with problems. Again, we need to deal with these without adding layer upon layer upon layer of governmental regulation. Let me say, too, that I think perhaps the most critical issue, and I'm biased because I'm an attorney general, and part of my job is to practice in front of the United States Supreme Court. The critical issue in this election is the Supreme Court, and who will make the next one, two, three, or four nominations for justices to the high court. That will alter the trajectory of our nation, of our soul and our culture, far longer than either of these candidates could. The next president will alter the appellate courts more than scope. Please don't believe that is one. With, like Floyd, I think Floyd and I agree. Those who've come before me to speak here at this dais today, issues as our next president to ensure and a comfortable life. He rode to the rescue. Expressing rare faith in the future, he was instrumental in kickstarting the regeneration of neighborhoods and landmarks almost given up for dead. That is the Donald Trump that I know. That is the vision that I'm excited about. I want to be frank. I was not immediately a supporter of Donald Trump. It took me a while. I don't agree with everything that he says, but to be honest, I don't even agree with myself 100% of the time. But when I carefully considered his track record of success, his willingness to stand up to power and speak to it, to break through gridlock and old ideas, and when I considered his commitment to his family, hard work, self-reliance, less burdensome regulations, and a dedication to faith and freedom, those are my values as an Asian Pacific American. I want visionary leadership, not the status quo. I want a new future and not old, unworkable ideas from the past. I humbly invite you to join me in supporting the next president of the United States, Donald J. Trump. Now, before I close, and because I'm not taking questions because I have a plane to get in a few minutes, questions. Vegas, and this is the mecca for a lot of boxing matches, some of the greatest of all times. And because sports heroes, a rope-a-dope gift, standing there smiling, pugilist, whatever you bring, because I'm the undisputed heavyweight and pound-for-pound king, hunting predators. I'm a dragon slayer, making believers out of all them haters, as I take down in my town criminals like a bloodhound on the scent till they're found. Follow them even underground, infiltrate their compounds, engulf them like surround sound. Don't mess around in my town. Ladies and gentlemen, conference.
Until we, all right. Just palace, but also for this whole community. And so We have asked Congresswoman Dina Titus, who is the local congressman here in Vegas, to come and give us our greeting, and we just have to thank her so much, not only on behalf of her community, but for her patience. Other political figures decided to talk a little longer than we could.
Well, thank you very much. Sometimes it's kind of fun to have the last word, and I think that's what I have today. And I want Mr. Louie to know that I do know what AAPI stands for, so thank you very much. Also, I want to tell you what a pleasure it is to serve with Mr. Honda in Congress. He is a friend and a mentor and a great voice for you. Let's give him another round of applause. Conference, the of my district. Very interesting town, including. And if you fall in love while you're here, you can get married at a drive-through wedding chapel with a mechanical arm that throws rice on your windshield. Keep that in mind. But what's especially exciting about it is that it's the most diverse district in the state of Nevada. And the AAPI community is the fastest growing ethnic community in all of the state. We have Downspring Mountain, we've got Koreatown, Japantown. We have one of the top 10 celebrations for the Chinese New Year. Along Maryland Parkway, we have a growth. So we are chose to have your conference here because it's so important. Personal indulgence, I want to. And I have to tell you that pretty late to dinner, you're still here. Thank you for being in the neighborhood. It was some picture. I have said, but this time it is really, really true. And the issues that are on the agenda are ones that are really affect the Asian Pacific Island community. Whether it is regulation for small business or access to quality education, whether it is immigration reform or human trafficking. These are things that really make a difference. And so you, as we say in Las Vegas, really hold a whip hand. You can make a difference. You know, and that's true not just in Nevada, but nationally. Here in Nevada, the AAPI community makes up 9% of the electorate. And we are known for very close elections, so you truly can make about who wins the white country far will stay the rest of the world. It's about are we together. We are smarter together, we are safer together, we are more prosperous together. And because it is action and make so much.
Thank you to all these people who yep, you had to stay awake. Getting this free beer. There's free beer. Don't miss, please, because and scholarships and all the great things that we do for a new generation of Asian American journalists. Our thanks to API Vote, AAJ, all of you guys. And all of those candidates and campaigns who appeared before us here today. And we're going to leave you with something we hope you're going to see a lot of. It's a piece done by NBC. Do that.
The power to chart a new course for our nation.
It's a new frontier, and it begins and ends with voting.
If you don't vote, you don't have a say.
Voting is a right and a privilege.
Voice your vote.
You can make a difference.
Register and vote.